Alone among the Muslim nations, Turkey is a country with a dream. For 70 years, she sat on the doorstep of Europe, waiting to come in. But do all Turkey's children really want a European home? And do the ones who keep the faith there think like us? Turkey's always been the odd man out, an eastern country facing west. A nation of 60 million people, the community has told them to reapply in 1993. But is Turkey as European as it looks?
Türkiye Avrupa'ya atlamak istiyor. Sanki Avrupa'nın duvarına yapışmış ve oraya çıkma gayretinde olan bir ülke ama henüz Avrupa ülkesi değil.
Turkey's future lies in looking at the west. And we consider Turkey as a European country.
Turkey has always been the bridge between two continents. The modern state has only a European toehold now, a relic of its former Balkan Empire. The old Ottoman capital of Istanbul has always been in Europe. But across the narrow passage of the Bosphorus, Turkey proper is in Asia, separated from the Middle East by a barrier of mountains. The Euphrates and the Tigris, the great rivers that rise in Turkey's highlands, reach the sea in the Persian Gulf. Ancient towns like Cizre guard the borders with the Arab nations. In this part of Turkey, you're a long way from Brussels, far nearer Baghdad.
This is the Tigris River, Turkey's border. That village over there behind me is in Syria. Half an hour's drive to the east and it's Iraq, then Iran, then Soviet Transcaucasia. Now the Turkish government would have us believe that this is Europe's front line. They guard our southern flank. But is that claim believable, even with the Gulf crisis with Iraq? Does Europe end where it's always done, on the waters of the Bosphorus, 1,000 miles away? Or does it end here, on this distant desert frontier?
Istanbul. This was a European city once, easy to believe that it could be again. Turkey is a familiar place these days.
100,000, big one.
In the past, military rule and human rights abuses, Turkey's old bad habits, used to stop us doing business. But the Turks now want to sell us more than the familiar souvenirs. This is where the action is these days. The stock exchange boiled over onto the pavement in 1989. People got the message that in the free market, they'd get a chance to make their pile. Money talks. Turkey was letting Europe know that perestroika was coming. First the economy would be liberated, then politics. It was one man's idea.
In the last 10 years, there was a basically a change in the social, economic and political change. There is a new program which we have introduced 10 years ago. And I believe today West generally saying same thing, which I said much, much earlier. Whole free market economy can go hand to hand with a liberal democratic system.
Turkey is selling her present sunlit image with reminders of her classical European past. Here at Afrodisias in central Anatolia, Turgut Özal and his wife Semra have come to play the presidential couple and open a site that attracted 250,000 visitors last year. Putting democracy back together after the 1980 coup is proving much more difficult. The politicians know the army is watching every move they make. If they get it wrong and the hurly-burly of democracy disrupts the orderly arrangements of the day, then the soldiers pull the house down.
We have to make what I call it structural adjustment, or maybe much more than that, a transformation. Transformation of a standstill society to a dynamic society that has been greatly achieved.
So far, the powers that be have gone along with Mr. Özal. Now, some are wondering precisely where he's taking them.
President Özal is a dynamic man with a broad vision, and he has really implemented things that we have not even dreamt of. He's a strong leader, but what he's implementing now and the liberalization should be more planned, in my personal opinion.
Sunay Kiraç is deputy chairman of one of Turkey's largest companies, Koç Holding. She's a living advertisement for how liberal and modern the country's become. There may be reservations about the Özal revolution, but Koç has seen its profits spiral upwards. Koç headquarters is an old Ottoman palace on a commanding site above the Bosphorus. With the Turkish economy open to the outside world, there's a novel threat of competition, but there are also opportunities. Koç is a giant conglomerate with a finger in everything, from fridges to construction to banking.
American Express'in ikinci adamı durumunda olan.
There's one word on everybody's lips: exports.
We are hoping to plan to be a multinational company because maybe you have noticed in Turkey most of the companies were designed for the local market. But now that Turkey is export oriented, our companies are becoming export oriented.
That means cars made here at Tofaş, Koç's pride and joy. These Fiat Temperas, one of Milan's latest models, may soon be on their way to Europe. Koç is investing $1 billion to double production and overtake her rivals. Turkey hopes to beat off the competition with a unique combination: high tech and low wages. The workers get only 80 pence an hour. But with 56% inflation, they want a big rise now. And that could jeopardize the whole investment. Dinner at the Koç home in Istanbul. It may be a $1 billion business, but it's still a family firm. Westerners can feel totally at ease with the people in whose hands Turkey's money is increasingly being concentrated. People like Vebe Koç, who founded the firm, and the next generation who run it. The Koçes feel as European as the wine they drink and the clothes they wear. This small elite now want a tighter bond.
Türkiye istikbali olan bir memlekettir. Ve bugün Türkiye ihracatının %80'i sanayi mamullerindedir. Bundan dolayı Türkiye Batı ile daima işbirliğine devam edecektir ve bu işe yere gidecektir.
In this Koç-funded museum, there's scarcely room for all the glories of Turkey's past. The collection pays corporate homage to philanthropy and culture. Fragile relics protected from the shocks of history by the Koç family.
These are plates and saucers made for the church and the mosque. The ones with the faces are for the church, and the ones with the designs are for the mosque.
The evidence of past intolerance is now confined behind the glass as history. The Holy War is over with the West. Those Muslim articles of faith are locked away. It was very different once. In the Middle Ages, all the Muslim world acknowledged the Turkish Sultan. And Europe's ambassadors to Istanbul knew that Turkey was more than a match for the West. In 1683, Christendom trembled as Suleiman II took his armies to the gates of Vienna. But that was the high watermark of Ottoman power. 2 centuries of decline began. The Turkish bogeyman became the sick man of Europe. The Ottoman Empire died on the battlefield in the First World War. The Sultan sided with the Germans and shared their fate. Defeat for Turkey meant dismemberment. Greeks, the most ancient of Turkey's enemies, ruled again in Istanbul. The Turkish heartlands were given to Greece and to Italy as colonies, as the victors took the spoils of war. One man, Mustafa Kemal, stood between the Turks and national extinction. He was an army officer who'd made his reputation at Gallipoli. He raised a new model army to fight for independence. Turkey had learnt the crucial lesson of how to be a disciplined and military nation. By 1923, the war was over. A grateful people hailed the army and its leader. General Kemal rebuilt society. He changed his name to Atatürk, father of the Turks. He taught them to wear Western dress like him. He hobnobbed with European monarchs as an equal. The European alphabet was introduced. It was a cultural revolution. No more Oriental fashions, strange new customs. Behbi Koç was an eyewitness to it all.
Büyük Millet Meclisi'nin açıldığı 21 senesinde Atatürk'ün verdiği nutukta bulundum ve kendisini orada dinledim. Atatürk çok geniş düşünceli, çok mühim bir insandı. Atatürk, Türkiye'nin istikbalinin batıda olduğunu söylemiştir ve bu hedefe doğru Türkiye'yi yönetmiştir.
Atatürk died in 1938. He is not forgotten. Like Lenin, they made a mausoleum for him. Foreign visitors pay their respects. Atatürk's sarcophagus is the ark of Turkey's political covenant. He left behind a conservative political movement called Kemalism. Kemalism has become a state religion. Its guardians are not priests, but soldiers. Every day, a fresh lesson in the cult of Atatürk, a tour around the leader's relics. Children are taught that the Republic is secular, not Islamic, that the West is the model, that the watchwords are peace at home, peace abroad. Nowadays, the soldiers add democracy to the list of what they safeguard. But democracy must fall in with the Kemalism they watch over.
Turkey is a democratic country, although we have had two coups in between the last 20 years. I think army is the guardian angel for Turkish democracy. So Turkey is a democratic country and it's going to be unified with Europe.
Islam has been the custom of the people here for virtually 1,000 years. Under the new republic, the state discouraged public piety in the hope that religion would wither on the vine. But Islam had cut too deep into the fabric of Ottoman society and the patterns showing through again. In the 1980s, a religious revival has gathered pace in Turkey. President Özal's economic changes have brought country folk flooding into town, and they've brought the old religion with them. Kemalism copies Europe. Its day of rest is Sunday. But as more people go to Friday prayers, fundamentalism's becoming difficult to ignore.
My father was a religious man, with some religious identities. Claiming himself as an Islamic man with his beard. My mother was covering her hair. Nobody cared about this because he was a shopkeeper and she was tending home. But when I became a journalist and when my wife has become a lecture at university, they started minding. They started feeling awkward about our coming to that places.
Femi Koru owns a Muslim newspaper called Zaman. It sells 100,000 copies every day to the new educated classes. Despite appearances, he says he doesn't feel a European. The readers, like the staff here, take their religion seriously, and they don't care who's watching. They're fighting a battle of traditions and ideas. You can measure the progress of that silent battle on the building sites of Turkey. Everywhere, new minarets are rising. But where does the money come from? The government says that mosques are built by private enterprise, but the Department of Religious Affairs has suddenly had its budget more than doubled, and no one seems to know where the money's going. And the special schools for training future mullahs have had a lot more money from the government. Arabic and religion are on the syllabus. They're turning out 70,000 pupils every year. One in eight university graduates comes from these schools now. Atatürk must be turning in his grave at the thought of computer programmers in Perda, not the future he commanded. And many of these lads will not be taking up careers as clergymen. And that's what worries Doğu Perinçek, editor of the left-wing magazine Yüzyıl. Doğu Perinçek is a veteran of struggles with the fundamentalists, and he's worried at what the future is going to bring.
Bu bin yıllık İslam bugün devlet içinde çok önemli pozisyonları ele geçirmiştir. Mesela İslamcı junta İçişleri Bakanlığı'nda yönetimi ele geçirmiştir. Birçok yerlerde kuvvetlidir ve bu da zaten pozisyonu, durumu son derece karmaşık hale getirmektedir ve Türkiye'yi çok sert hesaplaşmalara doğru itmektedir.
Fundamentalism now is the item on the Turkish political and social agenda. Of course, when there is an item on the agenda, it should be dealt with. And I think fundamentalism is an issue which the government should handle very delicately.
But firmly.
And firmly.
Mrs. Kiraç hopes that the problem will be solved by enlightenment and education. But in the past, challenges to Kemalist orthodoxy brought in the army. Today, the soldiers keep well out of the limelight. But this was a NATO exercise, our only opportunity of getting near the Turkish military. It's a conscript force, almost a million men. It's not like Latin America. The generals don't like taking power, but they don't like breakdowns in law and order either. So they keep on taking over the government. They've done it three times since 1960. The last time was just 10 years ago. The senior officers who carried out that operation are now retired. Some are prepared to talk.
They created a nation under the leadership of Kemal Atatürk. So once you create something, you want to keep it. You want to keep it in a good condition when it's supposed to be. That is the feeling you have to protect your country from the threat that can damage and jeopardize the peace and security of the country.
Internal threats as well as external threats.
Well, if the dimensions of internal threats, I mean, gets jeopardizes the country's independence and sovereignty and that sort of thing, and then you have to think that that's a great threat.
The soldiers cleared the field. The army blamed the politicians, especially the left. Thousands were arrested and tortured. The political parties were dismantled. Searching for allies against the left, the army decided to let Muslim fundamentalism grow. In 1983, as they relinquished power, the army chose the new prime minister. He was Turgut Özal, a conservative from a religious background. Turgut Özal has moved forward as the military stepped back, a civilian figurehead. But no one was able to tell us how much Özal still owes to the army. Can a figurehead come to life? It's hard to tell because he's always on the move. Last year, by an amazing piece of acrobatics, he made himself the president. With one bound, he was free and off to the White House to make foreign policy on his own.
Welcome back to the Oval Office.
Mr. Özal breaks the rules of cabinet democracy when he went to talk to Mr. Bush, the Turkish foreign minister, went with him, but the two presidents monopolized the Oval Office photo opportunities. And Mr. Özal spoke to Mr. Bush alone.
I do not think that even Prime Minister does not know what really Mr. Özal has discussed with President Bush about the Gulf crisis, about the Turkish commitment. Nobody knows. According to Constitution, we have the parliamentarian system. We do not have the presidency system. But after Özal, Mr. Özal became the president, to our opinion, against the Constitution, against law, against everything, against the parliamentarian system, he tries to practice the presidential system, and that is the problem. And actually, he has a big responsibility to collapse the system. The system is collapsing because of his personal attitude and behavior.
Your critics say that you're carrying out a constitutional coup, giving
yourself over. I'll give you an English copy of our constitution. You studied it. It's a kind of copy, basically, many articles has been copied from the French Constitution.
But that is like a motor car, it depends how fast you drive it.
That depends upon who is on the presidency in Turkey.
And you're a fast driver.
I am a fast driver, yes.